Let's move on to the Justice Department. It held two briefings yesterday, mainly for Congress, on an FBI informant's role in the Russian probe. Yet the meeting stirred even more controversy when, get this, the president's in-house counsel showed up. That's right, for an intel briefing that involves the exposing of an FBI informant, exposes the methods used by the intel agencies. This was supposed to be to make sure that the FBI had kept things in between the line and wasn't about Donald Trump personally. It was about the nation as a whole. At least that's the garbage that we've been hearing from the administration and Devin Nunes. And then Donald Trump's personal lawyer, who's going to be defending him in any possible criminal cases, shows up. Well, the White House Chief of Staff, John Kelly, was also added to the participants list on Wednesday and arrived at the White House with special counsel Emmet Flood, who's representing the president in the Russian probe. Senate Intel Committee Vice Chair Democrat Mark Warner tweeted, "For the record, the president's chief of staff and his attorney in an ongoing criminal investigation into the president's campaign have no business showing up at a classified intel briefing." In the hallways of Congress, Warner said this while the president's chief of staff, John Kelly, kept walking.
It was inappropriate that Kelly and Flood were there.
There's never been a Gang of Eight meeting with that kind of White House presence.
Yeah, you know, Michael Steele, you know why he didn't answer? Because there is no good answer
to this.
There
is no good answer.
This is another violation of constitutional norms. This is the president of the United States lying about what the FBI has been doing, lying about what Republican FISA court judges have been doing, lying about what the Justice Department has been doing, lying, lying, lying.
Yep.
Then battering the Justice Department of the FBI to have a briefing because there were supposedly, quote, spies in his campaign. And then they go ahead and have that briefing, and his criminal lawyer turns up.
Yeah.
His criminal lawyer turns up to figure out who informants are and to further expose the methods of the Federal Bureau of Investigation and the intel community in general.
Well, this is my recommendation to everyone who's currently under investigation by the FBI. The next time they have a meeting, you make sure you have your folks show up and get all that intel as well, because what the president's team did yesterday is something no other citizen in this country would be permitted to do, and that is to have their counsel and their executive chief officer from their business, if you will, inside a meeting
to figure out what evidence the FBI has against them in an ongoing criminal probe.
Exactly. And this is what twists my stuff in a knot, is that Republicans are complicit in this crazy. And they're sitting here now and dumbing down the system. They're disintegrating the very pillars of justice in this country, A, by going after those institutions like the FBI and the DOJ, but then permitting the president to behave in a way in which no other American citizen, and they know damn well this is true, would be able to behave.
You know, Heidi, no man is above the law in America. That's been part of our creed when it comes to justice for a very long time. But Donald Trump, right now, because of Republicans in the House of Representatives especially, is an American who is above the law. The rules do not apply to Donald Trump during investigation. The rules do not apply to Donald Trump because people like Paul Ryan and Devin Nunes say the rules that apply to you and me and 320 million Americans don't apply to him.
We've seen that in such vivid display this week, Joe, day after day, yesterday as well, when Paul Ryan was asked, do you think that this is having any impact on our institutions? And he says point blank, no, but it's Friday, so let's do a week in review. Just this week, it's not just what happened yesterday. It was the outing of a confidential source. It was the president himself ordering this meeting, calling Rosenstein and Ray and DNI Director Coates and saying that he wants this meeting, and then not even trying to hide it, sending his own personal lawyer there and having Rudy Giuliani coming out afterwards and saying, well, it depends on how much information we get. So it's in full view and it's intentional. They're almost cutting out the middleman here, Devin Nunes, who, at least in previous iterations with the wiretapping, the bogus wiretapping claims and the unmasking claims, would run over in the dark cloak of night to the White House to give them the information. Here they're doing it in full display.
Oh, yeah. It's really unbelievable. And Rudy Giuliani, by the way, yesterday when asked about the summit, said, oh, well, we may not be doing the summit, but we may because Donald Trump won't be entrapped. What did he say? He won't be entrapped in a Korean perjury trap. It's amazing to me that any lawyer thinks that their client is such a liar that the first thing that comes to mind, even when they're not talking about a possible criminal investigation, is still obsessed with the fact that they have a client who cannot stop from lying long enough to be committing perjury. So even some Republicans, by the way, yesterday, just so you know, were taken aback by this constitutional breach. Lindsey Graham told PBS that it's a bit odd if the president's lawyer is there. I'd like to know why, as would we. In a statement, the White House said neither Chief Kelly nor Mr. Flood actually attended the meetings, but did make brief remarks before the meetings started to relay the president's desire for as much openness as possible under the law. They also conveyed the president's understanding of the need to protect human intelligence services. No, too late, too late, too late. It's too late because the president's recklessness has exposed the identity of somebody that has helped the intel community for years now. So, Jeremy, I just got to ask you, it's just sort of a general question about where we are in this investigation. Donald Trump has been, how would the Greeks say this? He's been freaking out this week.
He used that term a lot.
They did. It was one of Socrates' favorite expressions. Stop ye freaking out,
because
we know
stop,
it is. We know that the Greeks use the word ye a lot also.
Yeah.
But
old English.
Donald, exactly. It's really Greek, the old English. I mean, it was picked up in the old English language. I'm sorry, Alex, I'm getting there. But Donald Trump has been freaking out so badly this week, since Sunday, and all these crazy tweets and talking about Spygate. It's all like he's losing it. Mm. On the other side, you have Bob Mueller being Bob Mueller. And Rod Rosenstein, after this is over, he can do weekend gigs like Henny Youngman used to do up in the Catskills. Because Rod Rosenstein and Bob Mueller are acting like men or women sitting around a table in a poker match that are getting insulted, and they're looking at their hands, and they have four aces. You pick that up with Rosenstein? Every time he goes out, he's just sitting there smiling. Yeah. And then last night I heard on Chris Hayes, we haven't confirmed it yet, but somebody said on Chris Hayes that they've got this kill trigger. You start firing us, we just press the button, and the indictments start getting emailed out. Are they holding four aces already? Are they not fearful of Donald Trump firing them? Do they have this all planned out? Do you think that if he does start firing them, they press the button and all the indictments start getting sent out?
Yeah, I don't know if they think they have four aces, but I don't think they fear the president or other defendants or putative defendants in this matter. First of all, we should say on the content of this whole, quote, controversy, Spygate, we hardly knew ya.
I mean,
it came
gone.
And went. It's a right. Puff. It's over. It was, in terms of content, it was a nothing burger. There was nothing to the allegations.
You know what some at Fox News were saying? That this was bigger than Watergate.
Yeah.
You remember the FISA judges?
Yeah.
That was bigger than Watergate until they found out that the four FISA judges were Republicans.
They're not going to drop this, though. We don't know that yet.
No, but
we haven't heard from Nunes. We haven't heard from Gowdy. And an administration official on background yesterday said it really doesn't matter what we learn in this meeting because it's not going to be conclusive to prove that there wasn't a spy.
Yeah, so first, I think on content, there is nothing to inappropriate spying allegations. And Rod Rosenstein did put that to bed the other day, as you noted. You know,
right.
If there's any allegation of inappropriateness, we'll get to the bottom of this.
Sure.
Of course, he knows there isn't any allegation of inappropriate use of confidential sources. But second, Joe, and this is back to the issue of Emmet Flood, the presence of the president's personal lawyer here. The thing that's so concerning is it's not just like the CEO's general counsel showing up at a meeting with the investigators or the mafia boss's consigliere. This is the president's White House counsel. This is being done under the color of law. This is a not just a use of office, this is a misuse of office, a misuse of White House authority. The putative reason is, well, we oversee the Justice Department. We have an equity in this whole matter. We just want to make some opening remarks. Come on.
Yeah.
This is a total abuse of power. And Emmet Flood, who is a, I respect his intellect. He's a good lawyer. I've worked with him in the past. He knows better. This is a destruction of the constitutional norms that would that should take the president and any criminal or otherwise defendant out of this kind of discussion.
I mean, Katie, let's just again clarify this to make it as simple as possible. You have the president of the United States subject to an investigation, a possible criminal investigation. And that president is not only interfering with the Justice Department and the Federal Bureau of Investigations, he is actively attacking them only as it pertains to his investigation. He's not saying they're dropping the ball on other responsibilities. It all involves his own personal investigation, which of course makes it an extraordinary breach of constitutional norms.
Yes, and as he does so, he watches the opinion polls, which show that his approval numbers are ticking up and that the number of Americans who think this investigation is politically motivated is also ticking up. And every time he tweets out Spygate or even calls a meeting like this with the display of wanting to investigate Spygate, every time he uses the word on Twitter, he knows that with a certain portion of the public, that is starting to resonate. And, you know, you repeat it, you repeat it, you repeat it, and there will be people who start believing it. And he can start looking at his approval numbers and start linking that just because the economy is ticking up, if nothing else, and then he starts thinking that he has more credibility when he starts attacking the Russia investigation.
Yep.
And the numbers seem to be suggesting that it's working.
We'll see. We're still ahead on Morning Joe. As Heidi mentioned, Paul Ryan brushes off concerns about lasting damage inside America's institutions. Well, the House Speaker told Casey Hunt about the president's ongoing attacks against the FBI, the Justice Department, and our law enforcement agencies. Plus, the Wall Street Journal tracks down an email that calls into question Roger Stone's testimony to Congress. That's really shocking. When he actually specifically says what date he needs a WikiLeaks email from.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. And you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.